So today, as we have all gathered together, I invite you all to open your Bibles this evening as we would be focusing on the topic, what is in your heart? What is in your heart? The topic for this evening is what is in your heart? And the Bible text is from Acts chapter 8. Verses 9 to 20. Acts chapter 8, verses 9 to 20. And this is from the NIV, Acts chapter 8, verses 9 to 20. And this is how it goes. Now for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is rightly called the great power of God." They followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his sorcery. But when they believed Philip, as he proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized, and he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and the miracles he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers there that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come on any of them. They had simply been baptized in the name of Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." May God bless the hearing and the reading of his word. So before we get into an understanding, before we break down these verses to have an understanding on what the Holy Spirit is trying to lead us into, I would all like us to prepare our hearts, prepare ourselves, because preparation is something which is very, very important. Without preparing ourselves, we cannot invite the Holy Spirit in our lives. So let us prepare our hearts, prepare our minds, and let go every distraction which is there in our life. Distraction which is pulling us down. Distractions of our mobile phones, distraction of our thoughts, of our day-to-day activity, distraction of everything which is drawing us away from the word of God, so that we can prepare ourselves to receive the light, to receive the Holy Spirit for an understanding of his word this evening. Holy, 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 O Lord. Father, we thank you so much for all your grace, your mercies. We thank you for all the wonderful gifts which you give to us every blessed day, O Lord. Father, though we do not deserve any of it, O Lord, but we thank you, O Lord. We thank you, O Lord God, that you from your storehouse have been supplying to us bountifully, O Lord. Bless us with thy Holy Spirit, that thy word should be sown in our hearts, O Father, that we should abide by it and live our life understanding it, O Lord God. In the blessed name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You know, this story which we have read is not something which is out of the box. This story is we might have read many a times about our dear friend Simon the sorcerer. So this story is related to our day-to-day life, and especially my friends, my family, as we are in the end times now, as we are in those times where there is a good doctrine, there is a good message which has been shared by the children of God, and at the same time, there are doctrines which are drawing us away from the gospel, because the word of God says that during the end of times, even the most elected ones of his would be deceived because the way things would come in their life. So today we would be trying to understand what the Holy Spirit would teach and preach to each and every one of us. We would try to understand that in this time, in this world which we are in, how do we have a discernment of the Spirit? What do we do that we should understand the right gospel? What do we do that we should not be going towards darkness but should remain in the light? Because I tell you, sometimes it is very, very difficult for us to understand that where do we go, what do we follow, how do we try to use the right doctrines, the right word of God in our day-to-day lives. Because Paul very precisely says this in Timothy as well, that the time is very near when people will not like sound doctrine, when people will not enjoy the word of God, when people will be getting away from the right principles, the right things which Bible is to offer to us. So today, in fact, if you look around the whole world, so many people have sprouted off, so many lives have come up who are proclaiming that they are preaching the right gospel. But today, as a believer, as a born again, as a child of God, it is very important for us to understand that where are we heading? Because are we following the right people? Are we following the right doctrines? Are we following the right message which God himself is delivering to us? Or are we moving towards darkness? Or are we moving towards what the enemy has planted in our lives? When we read Matthew chapter 24 verses 22 to 24 going, it says, "And expect those days should be shortened. There should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not, for there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, and shall shew great signs and wonders, in so much that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect as well." Even Jesus himself was preaching this. He was teaching this to his disciples 2,000 years back, that my children, this is what would happen in the end times, that even the elected ones, even the ones who are very focused, even those who are born again, who are very closely connected with Christ, even they will get deceived looking at the signs, the wonders, the miracles which the enemy will perform. God has created all in his own likeness. His Spirit resides in each and every one of us. But many a times it is the enemy who comes and takes away that blessing, that spirit, and leads that spirit towards darkness. Today, my family, my friends, if you look around, you know, this prosperity gospel has been preached by so many. This prosperity gospel has been spoken out in such lengthy ways that sometimes even the elected ones, sometimes even those who are closer in communion with God, even they get confused at whom should we follow. If you do not know about the prosperity gospel, it is something wherein everything is positive. Today, even if someone who falls short in the glory of God, and when he goes to these prosperity preachers, they would be preaching everything good to them. They would not be saying that, brother, you have to repent, or sister, you have to repent, or you have to fall in line with the expectations of God. If your heart desires, whatever you are desiring should be in line with God's expectation. They would not preach that, but rather they would say that whatever you have desired for will surely come to pass. Whatever you are praying for, be it anything, and especially their focus is always on all the materialistic things. If you are looking out for a good house, they would say you would be blessed with a house. If you are looking out for a good car, they would say that you will be blessed with a good car. If you are looking for all the materialistic gains, they would say that certainly you will get all those. But you know, the Bible is talking something else. The Bible says that blessings will follow. Prosperity will follow, growth will follow, because God is a God who takes care of all our needs. But then he says that what is the most important thing for us to do? He says that what is the most important thing? He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your spirit. That is the most important thing. And to love your neighbor, that is what Jesus says in his second commandment, that love your neighbor like you love yourself. When he says love your neighbor, that sums up everything. That sums up that we should live a good life, a life which is as per the will of God. We should live a life which he thinks is as per his expectations. Because none of us, if you look into our lives, none of us are just being created for fun's sake. We all have a purpose in our life. Just, you know, I don't know whether you think on these lines or not, that what exactly are we living for today in this world? What are we gaining in this world today? Is it just that we are born in this world so that we can have a good education, we can have a good job, thereafter have a good family, and thereafter when we become old, we leave all our inheritance for our children, and then we sleep in the Lord? Is that all is what we look at? Because if we are looking at on these lines, then it is something which is very disappointing, because God has not created us to be a materialistic person, but he says that focus upon me, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and rest all shall be added unto you. Rest all shall be added unto you. So my brothers, my sisters, today, this evening, the Holy Spirit is encouraging each and every one of us that we should understand, that we should understand that where are we heading? Are we heading towards the light which will open the doors to each and every one of us towards the eternal light, or are we moving towards darkness? Because I tell you, the enemy is so smart. Satan is so smart that he will trap us. He will always try to trap us. You know, the best illustration to make us understand is when we trap a mouse. When we trap a mouse, what do? We lay the mouse trap. We lay a small piece of meat in that, and then we patiently wait that when that mouse goes around, he goes in, and then when he gets caught up, that is wherein we kill that mouse. In the similar way, Satan always lays traps in our lives. He lays those little traps in our lives, and he patiently waits and watches. Always he's watching that we should get out of our walk of life, that we should get distracted from the word of God. And then we, if we fall prey to that trap, we will get caught up in the enemy's hand. You know, Jesus said that, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves, but you should be wise as serpents and harmless as doves." But that you should be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Jesus himself is saying that we will be living among the wolves, who will always be ready to devour us, who will always be ready to attack us. But we should be smart enough. We should understand that, where are we heading? What are we doing? Because end of the day, if we are not understanding our life, where it is turning to, then our life will be a disappointment at the time of Jesus's coming. Because we are in a fallen world, and this world has lot of limitations. But Jesus says that, "I am the life, I am the light, and I have come down to give life to you, and life in abundance." So we should not be focused upon this small life which we are living in this world, but rather focus upon that eternal life which God has promised to each and every one of his child. It is not only for we, but it is a promise which has been given to all. It is a promise which he says that everyone can enjoy this life. Anyone who is coming closer to me can enjoy this life. So end of the day, it is we who have to understand that, where are we heading? The second thing, the most important thing, which also talks about the topic, is having the right heart. Having the right heart. Chapter 16, verse 7, it says, "The Lord does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Man always looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. When Samuel had gone to anoint the sons of Jesse, one after the other, seven sons had come down, but the Lord rejected them. And finally, it was David who had come down, and the word of God came to Samuel that this is the one whom you have to anoint, because you should not look at the outward appearance, but look at the heart, because a heart is something which pleases God. That is why David has been said a man after God's own heart. Now, coming back to our text, when we read verse 21, it says, "You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." You are full of bitterness and captive to sin. If you see the life of this sorcerer Simon, he was living in that town Samaria, where a lot of people were there, and he had a pride in him. He had that boastfulness in him that he used to do that magic, he used to do that sorcery, and he used to attract the people. And when he used to attract the people, people used to believe and think that he's got the power from God himself, that God himself has blessed him with all these things which they get amazed with. And they used to be happy with the way this sorcerer used to do things. They used to be astonished. They used to be connected with him. And he was doing these things in their lives for a long time, for a lengthy time. But end of the day, when we read verse 21, it says that his heart was full of bitterness. His heart was a captive of sin because he was not right in the sight of the Lord. very, very important for us to understand that today, what kind of a heart do we have? What kind of a heart do we see in those who are preaching the word of God to us? What kind of a heart do we see in the life of those who are in our midst, who are in our circle, who are in our family, who are in our fellowship, who are in our groups, who are in our offices? Because a good heart will give good returns. A good heart will give blessings. A good heart will spread all good things. But a bad heart will deceive. A bad heart will do things which are not right in the sight of the living God. A bad heart will always have bitterness. It will be a captive to sin. When we read Galatians chapter 5 verses 19 to 21, it talks about all the works of the flesh. It talks about all those things which are connected with the wrongdoings in this world. All the adultery, the lewdness, the sorcery, the uncleanliness, adultery, fornication, every sin is connected with the works of the flesh. And end of the day, it is the heart which takes all of these. It is the heart which gets connected with all of these. It is the heart which starts to get darkened up when we are influenced strongly by the works of the flesh. Today, the Holy Spirit is encouraging each and every one of us to understand our own lives. If we look into our own lives, we should have an understanding that where are we heading? Are we like that man, Simon? Are we like that sorcerer who is having that pride or that boastfulness? Or are we having a humbled heart, a heart which is pleasing to God? Second thing is also which is important to us is what are we doing today with our spiritual life? Where are we following? Are we going towards the light or are we going towards darkness? Because these are things which matter the most to us. My family, my friends, if you turn on your televisions, if you look around the world, even if you turn around to any gospel TVs and all, you will see people preaching, people performing miracles, people doing things. So much is happening around that sometimes we also get influenced by those men or those women. And we tend to think that these are the children of God. These are those anointed ones whom God has blessed. And God is using them for his kingdom. But let us all understand that discernment of the spirit, discernment of a person is very, very important. Today we have to understand that these people who are standing and preaching the word of God, these people who we see on the televisions, what kind of a life do they have? Where are they preaching the word of God? What kind of friends do they have? What kind of lifestyles do they have? What kind of a preaching are they doing? Is it that very old prosperity gospel? Or is it the exact word of God which talks about repentance, which talks about to have faith in God? It talks about how that we can fall in line with the expectations of God. It talks about preparations of the end times. It talks about how we have to live our life during this time, during this generation, which is very close to the coming of the Almighty God. Very, very important for each and every one of us to look into our lives and to look around as well to see that what this world is offering each and every one of us. When you read Revelations chapter 21 verses 8 and 9, when you read Revelations chapter 21 verses 8 and 9, it says, "But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all the liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." Which is the second death. So today, it's very important for us to understand that how are we living our lives? Because this life is a short life. You know, people, if you look at people all around us, 70 is what God has given. But if some people live 80, some 90, and some even 100. But what beyond 100? What beyond 100? The life gets still. The life gets still. And even after our 50s, 60s, even some people, even their 40s, all those health issues are there. Diabetes come in, blood pressure comes in, so many health issues. You know, man or woman, they both start getting weakened up in flesh. But here God, Jesus himself, is promising in his word that I am the door, that when you enter through me, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and I will give you life which is everlasting, a life which will never have any problems, any issues, never ever a tear will roll down from your eyes, no diseases, no problems, no tensions, no worries, never ever any affliction will come to you. You will have a healthy body, a healthy life, a life which will be always filled with happiness and joy. But yet we fail to accept it. Yet we fail to understand that promises. Yet we fail to live by those promises because our focus is very much attached with this world. Our focus is very much attached with the people in this world. Our focus is very much attached with all that is happening around us. And that is where we fall short of the glory of God. That is where we fall short understanding our blessed God. That is where we fall short in understanding that what God has laid in each and every one of our lives. Today, if you see the life of all those people around us, if you see the life of all those friends, all those family people who are around us, many of them, they do not even know that what or where they are heading. They do not even know that how their life is shaping or moving, because they have no goals, no spiritual goals. If you talk about the materialistic goals, yes, many of them, even you and I, have materialistic goals. When we say about that, we have to do this in life. Yes, those goals are there. But what about the spiritual goals? What about coming closer to God? What about those areas in our life which we have to mend, that God can abide in us and we can abide in the living Lord? Today, my family, my friends, the takeaway for all of us this evening is be away. The takeaway for all of us this evening is to be away. When you read Psalm 1, it says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of the sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does, he prospers in life. We cannot blend evil and God together in our life. We cannot have both sin and God together in our life. We cannot have them together, because God cannot be blended with evil. God cannot be blended with sin. God cannot be blended with all the wrongs in this world, or the wrongs which we are doing in our lives. The word of God says that we should be away from all those people who are influencing us towards the wrong in life. All those people who are wicked, all those people who are away from the word of God, all those people who are away from the gospel, all those people who are away from all those doctrines which God has given to each and every one of us. Every life has a blessing of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. The word of God says that if you lack in wisdom, you should ask for it, and he will give it to us freely. So my friends, my family, today the word of God, the Holy Spirit, is encouraging each and every one of us that in our day-to-day life, we will come across many Simons who will come and draw us towards them, who will come and take us towards that prosperity gospel, who will take us towards their view of life, who will take us towards their own agenda in life, who will take us towards their own personal interest. But we, as a child of God, we who are being blessed by His Spirit, we have to have that discernment. We have to ask God that, God, give me that blessing, that discernment of spirit, that I should understand that where am I going? Where am I heading? What kind of a life am I living? Because all these things are very, very important. Today, the word of God, as it has been read to us, that many believed, even Simon the sorcerer, he believed and he was baptized. But baptism will not give you salvation. Baptism will not give you eternal life. Baptism is only a situation wherein you yourself have to let go all your past wrongdoings. And when you get up from that water, when you get baptized and from the water, and when you come up, when you get risen up, you will be living a life which is fruitful, a life which will multiply towards the kingdom of God. So baptism will not buy salvation. Baptism will not buy eternal life. Baptism will not buy you the Holy Spirit. It is only a way to prepare ourselves to enter into that phase of life where we can commune with our Father, that we can have an experience of a born again life. As you see, even in this life of the sorcerer, even in the life of Simon, he believed and he got himself baptized. But when he saw that how Peter was blessing and laying hands and how the Holy Spirit was entering, that is wherein that seed which Satan had sown in his heart, it sprouted out. And then he said, I will offer money to you. I will give you money. I want that blessing so that I can also lay hands on others. That is when Peter says that your heart is a deceitful heart. Your heart is not right in the sight of God. Your motives are not right. Your motives are not right. In our walk of life, my brothers, my sisters, we come across people, we come across those lives who will make us believe to draw towards them, and they will hold the Bible in their hand. They will show us signs. They will show us miracles. They will show us wonders, and they will say that they are the child of God, but they will lead us towards darkness. Unless we have the discernment of the Spirit, unless we understand, and it can only happen when we read the Word of God. This understanding can only come when we focus upon Him. This understanding can only come when we are continually in communion with Him rather than in communion with those lives who are like that Simon the sorcerer. Because what happens is when we try to get influenced by such lives, we also try to live a life like them. We also try to do the same things like them. We also try to get influenced by their thoughts, their intellectuals, their thinking in life. And that is wherein we start to get attracted towards them. We start to get drawn towards them. And that is where we lose our focus in life. The word of God is very clear, very precise, that we are living among the wolves, but we should be wise and smart like the serpents and humble like doves. We should always be closer to God, that He should give us an understanding that how this life of ours should be led. And we should always move towards the light and not towards darkness. May this word sow a strong seed in each and every one of our lives, that we should live by the blessing of the Holy Spirit and be away from the darkness, that God should always, always, always show us that we should be able to discern the good from bad. May God bless you all. Amen, amen, and amen.